So good morning, everybody. We're going to start with an opening song before I hand over to Phil, who's going to lead us through. If we look a little bit cold, we're not putting it on. The heating is broken down in this building, and we've all got about 45 layers of clothes on. And I put a hat on, but that might be seen as indiscreet for a vicar in public worship. So we will see. But we will do our best. We love you so much that we're freezing for you. This, you may know this old great Advent hymn, O Come Emmanuel.
Thank you. Jesus, we look forward to celebrating your coming at Christmas time in this Advent period. Remember your words, remember your message to us, Lord. Holy Spirit, come fill us with that readiness for your coming. Amen. So this Sunday, the second Sunday in Advent, is traditionally Bible Sunday here in St. Budeaux Parish Church. So I'm going to start with Psalm 119, verses 9 to 16. How can a young person stay on the path of purity? By living according to your word. I seek you with all my heart. Do not let me stray from your commands. I have hidden your word in my heart, that I might not sin against you. Praise be to you, Lord. Teach me your decrees. With my lips I recount all the laws that come from your mouth. I rejoice in following your statutes, as one rejoices in great riches. I meditate on your precepts and consider your ways. I delight in your decrees. I will not neglect your word. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. So we come, if you have the service sheet for December that Stephen sent round with his recent emails, we come to the welcome section, which for this Advent season is framed around John chapter 1. If you'd like to join in with the words in bold. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God.
Through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made.
In him was life, and that life was the light of all mankind.
The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it.
The true light that gives light to everyone was coming into the world. He came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him.
Yet all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God.
The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us.
We have seen his glory, the glory of one and only Son, who came from the Father, full of grace and truth.
Join together in saying,
Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthy magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
And so, remembering our actions or lack of action that's gone before, we come before Jesus' throne and ask for his grace. Almighty God, our heavenly Father,
we have sinned against you and against our neighbour, in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, for our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry. And repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in the newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen.
May the God of love and power forgive us and free us from our sins, heal and strengthen us by his Spirit, and raise us to new life in Christ our Lord. Amen. And so I'm going to hand back over to the worship band, who are going to lead us in two worship songs now. These are the days of Elijah, followed by Yesterday, Today and Forever.
Oh,
So for our Working It Out section today, I wanted to link in with those opening verses from John's Gospel that we shared earlier on, and think about how those are the same verses found in this small St. John's Gospel here. I don't know if any of you recognise one of these Gospels. This is a reprint of the Active Service Gospel, produced to mark the centenary of it first being issued to all service personnel in World War I. Some of you at home may have an original copy passed down by a parent or a grandparent. In the front of every copy was a message from Lord Roberts saying, "I ask you to put your trust in God. He will watch over you and strengthen you. You will find in this little book guidance when you are in health, comfort when you are in sickness, and strength when you are in adversity." At the back of this reprinted version is a letter sent to the publishers by a soldier at the end of the war. He says, "When your small testaments were distributed on the common at Southampton, I, among others, accepted one in a more derisive than complimentary manner. I little dreamed that I should use it and find in it great consolation in lonely hours. I have learned to realise the great personality of the Saviour. When at night I have been on duty alone, with him by my side, and the Germans but 30 yards away, I realised that I need more than my own courage to stand the strain." While we're thankfully not faced with the horrors of the Great War at this time, there are parallels in these words with life today. Lord Roberts' words encourage us to turn to the Bible to find guidance in health, comfort when faced with sickness, and strength when faced with adversity. As we deal with this current coronavirus pandemic, this advice holds true for us in our circumstances today. So too can many of us identify with the soldier's search for consolation in lonely hours at the moment. And like that soldier, we can find the person of Jesus in the words of the Bible. The Bible is full of the truths, promises, and reassurances that we need to deal with everyday life. And when, like that soldier, we realise that life is more than we can handle in our own strength, with the help of the Holy Spirit, we can find our Saviour, Jesus Christ. So today, on this Bible Sunday, I'm encouraging us all to read the Bible, pray with its words, so that we might know Jesus and experience his love more closely. Let's pray. We thank you, Heavenly Father, for gifting us with the Bible, your words for us, inspired by the Holy Spirit. Thank you that your Spirit continues to work through these words, that in them we might find your comfort, strength, and guidance. When we find ourselves lonely or in dark places, may these words not be dry upon the page, but alive in our hearts and minds, that we might know your great love and your peace, which passes all understanding. Lord Jesus, in this Advent season, as we prepare to celebrate your coming to earth to save us, draw us back to your word, that we might know you more fully. As the light of the star drew the wise men to you in the stable, may your word light our path to you and your promise of salvation. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So we turn now to the liturgy on the service sheets in the working sound section. If you'd like to join in with the words in bold. But we have this treasure in jars of clay
to show that this all-surpassing power is from God and not from us.
We are hard pressed on every side.
But not crushed.
Perplexed.
But not in despair.
Persecuted.
But not abandoned.
Struck down.
But not destroyed.
May our Lord Jesus Christ himself and God our Father, who loved us and by his grace gave us eternal encouragement and good hope,
encourage our hearts and strengthen us in every good deed and word.
Hand over now to our readings, and Steve will then come forward and share his word for us today.
Our first reading is from Luke 21, verses 25 to 33. There will be signs in the sun, moon, and stars. On the earth, nations will be in anguish and perplexity at the roaring and tossing of the sea. People will faint from terror, apprehensive of what is coming on the world, for the heavenly bodies will be shaken. At that time, they will see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. When these things begin to take place, stand up and lift up your heads, because your redemption is drawing near. He told them this parable. Look at the fig tree and all the trees. When they sprout leaves, you can see for yourselves and know that summer is near. Even so, when you see these things happening, you know that the kingdom of God is near. Truly, I tell you, this generation will certainly not pass away until all these things have happened. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will never pass away. This is the word of the Lord.
Our second reading is taken from Romans 15. We who are strong ought to bear with the failings of the weak and not to please ourselves. Each of us should please our neighbours for their good, to build them up. For even Christ did not please himself, but as it is written, the insults of those who insult you have fallen on me. For everything that was written in the past was written to teach us, so that through the endurance taught in the scriptures and the encouragement they provide, we might have hope. May the God who gives endurance and encouragement give you the same attitude of mind toward each other that Christ Jesus had, so that with one mind and one voice you may glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Accept one another, then, just as Christ accepted you, in order to bring praise to God. For I tell you that Christ has become a servant of the Jews on behalf of God's truth, so that the promises made to the patriarchs might be confirmed, and, moreover, that the Gentiles might glorify God for his mercy. As it is written, therefore I will praise you among the Gentiles. I will sing the praises of your name. Again it says, rejoice, you Gentiles, with his people. And again, praise the Lord, all you Gentiles. Let all the peoples extol him. And again Isaiah says, the root of Jesse will spring up, one who will arise to rule over the nations. In him the Gentiles will hope. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you, Susan. Do you want to sit down for anything? We'll let you sit. We'll let the band sit down. Yeah, just hear me out. I know, you've got to be joking. This is the time for the sermon, you see, so we'll let them sit down and blow warm air on their cold hands. Say, ah. All right. Just as we come for our sermon, then a prayer. Father, we thank you again for the scriptures and pray now as I speak, that you'll have me to speak in the power of your Holy Spirit. Blessed Lord, who caused all holy scriptures to be written for our learning, grant that we may hear them, read, mark, learn, and inwardly digest them. And by patience and comfort of your holy word, we may embrace and ever hold fast the blessed hope of everlasting life, which you've given us in our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, if you'll just join us, we are St. Budeaux Parish Church on the edge of Plymouth in the UK, and today we are celebrating Bible Sunday. For those who may remember, if you were brought up in the Church of England, this little book here will do one of two things. You'll recognise and think, oh no, not that one again. Or you'll think, oh, what a lovely book. It's the Book of Common Prayer, and I've just read the special prayer, the Collect, for the second Sunday of Advent, which uses phrases from the Bible, patience and comfort and hope. And it struck me that there's so much you could say about the Bible. It's such an amazing book, and we're so grateful for it. But I just wanted to focus on those three things, really, about the scriptures. Patience, or endurance, it's the same word in the Greek language. Comfort or consolation, and hope. Patience, comfort, and hope. And I think they are qualities, aren't they, that people needed in the first century, the things they were going through. They've needed them in all the different centuries since. And at the moment, even in our country, with the time of coronavirus and with so many other uncertainties around us, patience, comfort, and hope are very needed characteristics and make life so much more different and help us also sense the presence of God. So the Apostle Paul, as he writes to his friends in Rome, talks about the patience and comfort of the scriptures and that they lead to hope. How does he have that confidence? How does that work? And I really have some simple thoughts to share with you about patience, comfort, and hope coming from the scriptures. And what I want to do is basically take four different stories from the Old Testament, which when Paul wrote his letters, that great first Christian leader, they didn't have the New Testament yet, that hadn't been written down, although some of it would have been in existence, but the Old Testament was their scriptures. So here are four characters, and how do they help us find comfort, patience, and hope? Well, let's think of Isaiah, who we've been thinking about in our church for a number of weeks, who 800 or so years before Jesus heard God speaking and heard God promising a rescuer. And Isaiah was able to capture the promises of God that God was speaking and write them down for the future. And then we see, for example, comfort my people, or for example, for to us a son is born, to us a child is given. And the government will be on his shoulders, and his name will be called Wonderful Counselor, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. But then we see how these are fulfilled in the birth of Jesus. And so there's this great train of thought that says that God promised he would send someone to rescue the world, to bring a new age of comfort and peace. And then we see how that is fulfilled in the life of Jesus. And one of the big themes in the life of Jesus is just how he fulfills God's promises. When he says at the very beginning of his ministry, the time has been fulfilled, repent and believe the good news. He knows that he stands in the place to bring about all that God was promising for his world. And he is helping people taste the love of God for themselves. So Isaiah is fulfilled, his prophecy is fulfilled in Jesus. And that gives, because we know God can keep his promises, that's a very good reason for comfort, patience, and hope. Or go right back to the beginning of so many of the Bible stories and the story of Abraham. God spoke to this man who was very old, and his wife who was very old, and promised them that they would have a child. And the promise comes true. Isaac is born. And God promises to Abraham and to Isaac and then to his son Jacob that from them many people will come. Abraham will be the father of many nations. There will be as many descendants as there are stars in the sky. And it's a wonderful promise. And he promises that through their descendants the world will be blessed. And God keeps his promise. And through the whole of the Old Testament story, you can see how God is keeping his faithful promises of loyalty and love, and that the people, through really great dangerous times and disaster times, are still kept as the people of God, and that then Jesus is born into that family of people, and through him blessing will come to the whole world. So God is seen as a God of faithfulness, of loyalty and love. And again, if God can keep his faithfulness to his people and his loyalty and love for generations, he can keep his faithfulness and loyalty and love to you and to me in these days, in our lives. And that's another great reason for our hearts to be encouraged and for us to find patience, comfort and hope. Or, purely simply because this is one of my favourite stories, the story of Gideon in the Old Testament. Gideon lived in a time when the people of God are in the promised land in Israel, but things go wrong because the people desert the God who saved them, the God who has rescued them, the God who has given them their promised land. And then God sort of removes his complete protection from them for a while, and they are invaded by marauding enemies. And Gideon, as the story begins for him, is hiding away. He's not a man full of natural bravery and decision-making. The Bible doesn't spare his blushes, really. God speaks to him and sends an angel and says, "The Lord is with you, brave and mighty man." And he sort of thinks, "Who, me? Not, surely not me." But God promises him, "With my help, with me with you, you can defeat the enemies that are destroying your country." And he gives him some tasks to do. And Gideon wriggles and tries to get out of it, sort of makes excuses. And even when he performs his first task, your mission, Jim, is to do this. His first task is to destroy idols to foreign gods. And and he does it at night, so nobody knows. But eventually he starts to get the picture, and he follows what God is telling him to do. And then God even reduces the size of his army. He tells you, you can't win this battle with a big army. You've got to get rid of loads of people. And he reduces this army down to a tiny number of people so that everybody will know that when he defeats the enemies who are invading his country, it isn't Gideon's strength and power and wisdom and strength to win the day. It is the power of God. So what you have in Gideon is a really encouraging story of somebody whose weaknesses are obvious. I'm not being unkind to him, but he has enough faith, and God works through him. He works through an ordinary, flawed human being to bring glory to his name. And that, again, must give us hope. Unless you think you're perfect, unless you think you have no weaknesses, which it does, in which case it's irrelevant to you, but the great news is that God will work through, in his love, ordinary, flawed human people. And that's us, isn't it? And that's the whole of the Bible story, over and over again. God working through ordinary people in spite of their sins and weaknesses and lack of gifts sometimes. But God is at work. Isaiah, Abraham, Gideon. Then my final one, we sang about him earlier in our service, Elijah, who is a great prophet. That means he hears from God and then speaks his word out to the people around him. And Elijah lived in a time, again, when the people of God were deserting their God, worshipping foreign gods and not following justice and caring for the poor. And the king Ahab of the day was one of the most wicked kings who ever lived, and his wife Jezebel was just like him. And Elijah challenges them and says, you know, unless things change, there's going to be a drought. And so there's a drought. But even in the drought, God keeps Elijah alive. He feeds him in a miraculous way. It's a very moving story, how God just provides for his needs. And then he challenges all the false prophets to return to the Lord their God. And there's great miracles. And it's an amazing return to God. But then Elijah has a meltdown. He gets full of fear of Queen Jezebel, his arch enemy, as it were now. And when he has a meltdown, he goes off into the desert and he lies down and he wants to die, basically. It's a dreadful moment for him. But God is gracious to him, gives him some food, and then lets him go on further on into on his journey, and then meets him on a mountain in a cave and speaks to him in a gentle whisper and recommissions him. So in this story you have again God's faithfulness, but Elijah clearly has a second chance, and God is gracious and patient with him and patient to him and restores him with love and kindness. And the God who gives people a second chance, that's got to be good news for us, hasn't it? Do you know anybody who's never needed a second chance or a third chance or a fourth chance? And God is patient with his people and gives him time. So just from these four examples, we can see different elements, how as these different people encountered God, God brought about change, hope, and there is comfort, and there is encouragement, and there is patience for them. And you can tell the stories from two different perspectives. You can tell it from the perspective of the human people and what they did in all of their flaws and weaknesses. Or you can also tell it from the perspective of this is what God was doing. God was the one who was restoring his people, leading his people forward, bringing a blessing into the world, preparing for Jesus to come, and preparing to bring the ultimate cause of comfort, patience, and hope, Jesus Christ himself. And just to make it clear, Paul uses this phrase about the scriptures that are full of comfort and encouragement and patience, and then he uses those phrases about God himself. So if the scriptures bring patience, God is the God of patience, he says. And the scriptures that bring comfort, God is the God of comfort, he says. So he makes a clear link between the nature of the scriptures and what they can do as we let them dwell in our hearts, and the nature of God himself. Because in the end, this isn't about worshipping a book, or about even believing in a book in itself. What it means is it's a book that helps us believe in God, because it records for us what God is like and helps us encounter God. So it's that direct encounter with God that the scriptures want to lead us to. And he does the same with the word comfort and encouragement and patience and consolation. And he does that with hope as well, because he says that these scriptures, that the comfort that they have and the patience that they have will lead us to hope. That's what his prayer for us. But then at the end of that passage we have read for us, he talks about the script that God is the God of hope, the God of all hope. And he wants us to be filled with hope from God. So again, he makes that clear link between the hope that the scriptures can cause to dwell in our hearts and rise up in our hearts, and God himself, who by his Spirit will bring to us hope. How can we then cooperate with this so that we can let God's comfort and God's patience and God's hope increase in us? Because it's obvious they can increase. It's a bit like muscles. If you exercise your muscles properly, I think I've got some somewhere in my arms, but if you exercise properly, you'll get muscles. And if you exercise with the Bible properly and with encountering God properly, you will grow in comfort, patience, and hope. And again, these three things, they are such important things, aren't they? And Paul writes in Colossians, let the message of Christ, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly. Now, if we want to do that, it will take time and effort. It isn't just going to happen by quickly opening your Bible for a few seconds. Wow, kapow, wonderful. You understand the whole thing and God is with you. Amen forever. It just isn't that simple. You might wish it was, but it isn't. It takes discipline sometimes. And let me tell you the truth, sometimes, I am a great Bible fan, as you might have gathered, but sometimes it can be really irritating. I'm just checking with the band. Anybody ever found the Bible irritating? They're nodding at me, they are being honest too. Because there are bits you don't understand, or even worse, there are bits that you do understand, but you really don't want them to be true. So it takes time and energy and attention. And anything really that you do that's important can take time and attention. It's obvious. I've been trying to learn Italian on a free app 5 minutes a day, but sometimes I'm really glad when the 5 minutes is up, because I'm making so many mistakes, it's taking forever. And I'm also trying to teach myself a bit more guitar, and I've been learning the blues scale in E for all of those who like this sort of thing. And one day I'll get to the point where I can do it without making any mistakes. So anything you do, and reading the Bible, takes time to gradually learn how to interpret it, how to let it become part of our life. But the thing is, it is really worth persevering with it. That's what I want to encourage you. If you find the Bible, I mean, if you're out of sorts with God, you will find the Bible annoying, probably. If you don't really want to hear what God is saying, you won't want to open it up. But let me encourage you, it must be obvious that in our Christian walk with God, and even if we don't believe in God at the moment, comfort, encouragement, hope, patience, these are rock solid things that human beings need. And if you knew, if you were hungry and you knew there was a source of food, you would get the food. If you were thirsty and you needed a drink, and there was a drink available, you would get it. Now these things are available, is our message. It would be madness, wouldn't it, not to go to a source where you can find these things strengthened. And my advice would be, start by opening the Bible. There's a lot of books in the Bible. Take the Gospels that tell us the stories of Jesus. Matthew, Mark, Luke and John. And Mark is the shortest. So start by reading. If you've given up, start again by reading Mark's Gospel. And just read a little bit a day. My wife Caroline always says, start by doing 7 minutes, because 5 minutes is too short. You might not manage 10, so 7's a good place to start. Just and try and ask some questions. What does this tell us about God? What does it tell us about me and us? And what are we going to do about it? And ask God's help. And I've got a great theological phrase here for you. If you have lost the habit of reading the Bible, or if you're struggling with it, just start again today. You might have beginner's luck. And it might just speak to you. There is a theological phrase for that, which is the perspicacity of the scriptures, which means that the scriptures are understandable by ordinary people with the help of the Holy Spirit. So I really do believe. So, and then there are booklets we can help you get hold of to help you understand, and they'll give you a passage day by day and some comment about it. And there are lots of apps these days, if you're into phones and computers, that will speak, that will take you through. BibleGateway.com is a great resource with lots of things on it. BibleGateway.com is great, easy to get hold of if you have the internet. Ultimately, the scriptures point us to Jesus. Martin Luther, one of the great German reformers from previous centuries, said that the Old Testament is like the swaddling clothes that the baby Jesus had, like that carry Jesus, and the New Testament, you see him completely. And why the scriptures bring about for us patience, comfort, and hope is because they point us to Jesus. I think as Phil was saying in his words about working it out, it is so true that that is where they lead us to, and that's what we want to embrace, that's who we want to encounter, that's who we want to know more deeply. So let us give thanks to God for the scriptures. And I pray that we may be able to learn from them, and particularly again, patience, comfort, and hope. And there's so many other aspects we could take, but those three alone are surely worth reading the scriptures for. Let's pray. Father, thank you for the gift of your word, and I pray that you'll renew us in wanting to learn from it, and that give us grace that when we open it up, we will find peace with you. That we can put our lives in your hands, that we can find the forgiveness that we need. That we can recognize, Lord Jesus, that you are Lord. And that again and again we can put our lives in your hands and find from you patience, comfort, and hope. Because you are the God of patience, the God of endurance, the God of comfort, and the God of hope. In Jesus' name, Amen. I should hand back to Phil.
As our band start to make their way back up, we're going to sing Lord for the Years to wrap up our time of worship this morning. And so with the words of that hymn and the words that Stephen has shared for us this morning, we come to wait upon the Holy Spirit, to wait to hear what God has to say for us in prayer this morning. Holy Spirit, come share the words of the scriptures, come share the words of the gospels, come share the words of the Bible with us afresh this morning, we pray. Holy Spirit, come fill our hearts and minds with the hope that you offer. As we come to the Bible, so often, as Stephen said, we can be challenged with the words on the page before us. Holy Spirit, we pray for wisdom and discernment when we come to your words, that you might speak the truth into our hearts. Jesus, we pray that your words not be dead upon the page, but be living in us and through us. We pray for all those suffering, all those in need, all those mourning at this time, Lord. Lord Jesus, open our eyes through your words to where we are needed in this your world. Thank you, God, this morning that we are freed to open our Bibles, that we have that freedom to hold the Bible in our hands, to access your words freely. We pray, Lord, for all those Christians, all those seekers around the world who don't have those freedoms. We pray for those persecuted. We pray for those who would face imprisonment if they were found with of the Bible. Lord God, may your Holy Spirit work into all corners of the world to bring those freedoms to our brothers and sisters in Christ. Thank you that the Bible tells us that when we pray, you are always there. You always listen. We are always heard, Lord. We thank you for this gift and your promises. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So we turn to our service sheets in the waiting section and we say together the Apostles' Creed.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
And we join together in the prayer that Jesus taught us.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever.
Jesus said, follow me, let us go out in the light of his word and follow his path. In the name of Christ, amen.
I'm not afraid.
Thank you for joining us this morning, and I pray that you'll have a blessed week ahead. Take care.